Good morning, students. Today we are going back further. In fact, during this vacation period, we started our online classes with the magnetic effect of magnetism and magnetar. We did moving charges and magnetism, then magnetism and matter. Then we shifted to modern physics and came back to electrostatics. Then we did current electricity. So again, back to magnetism. That is the magnetic effect of electric current. Okay. Oyster's discovery and all those things we study. Today, we will get into one more important concept, which has plenty of application, that is induction. Induction we studied in electrostatics, where charges are induced. That means charges will not be supplied from any outside source. That means it is generated from the object itself. Similarly, here also current will be induced. So when those charges move, it automatically becomes current. So that is what is known as electromagnetic induction. Two important points are there. One is electro, that is current, electricity. From where? Magneto. So we are going to combine electric property as well as magnetic property in this particular concept. That is electromagnetic induction. In fact, before we step into this, there is one thing that you should know, that is magnetic flux. Recently we did electrostatics, so we know what is electric flux and all. Gauss theorem, MC. There we defined electric flux, or we said that an electric flux exists whenever electric field is passed through an area. Similarly, a magnetic flux is said to exist whenever magnetic field lines pass through an area. Pass through an area means linked to an area. This should be understood very carefully. From this statement, you must have understood that for your magnetic flux to exist, two things are compulsory. One is an area is required, another is magnetic field is required. In fact, some books, they define magnetic flux as number of magnetic field lines passing through an area. But that is not a proper definition, you can say, because you simply cannot count how many magnetic field lines. Because each magnetic field line represents one magnitude of magnetic field. For example, one Tesla. It will be represented by a line. That means what? All the points on that line has a magnetic field of 1 Tesla. Next is 2 Tesla. One more magnetic field line. It will have a different, it will be a different line, 2 Tesla. We have taken a convenient value. Suppose in between I want to know 1.5 Tesla. I can draw a line 1.5 Tesla. That means that line, every point on that line represents what? 1.5 Tesla magnetic field. So how many such lines you can draw? It depends on how minutely you want to divide. You can divide it into 0.1 Tesla, you can represent one line. 0.01 Tesla. So that is why number of magnetic field lines passing through an area, okay, but you cannot really define magnetic flux line, because through however that small area, we can easily say there are infinite magnetic field lines. We can say easily. So magnetic flux we will define in a different way. Okay, we will define not in terms of number of magnetic field lines, but instead of what are the main requirements of a magnetic flux. One is magnetic field, another is area. Based on this, we will define magnetic flux. So the requirement is, magnetic field lines must be linked to an area. That is very, very important. suppose magnetic field lines bypass that area. There may be an area, there may be magnetic field, but still no magnetic flux exists. So this is where we are going back to the electric flux concept. First we will talk about area is important, therefore area vector. Already you know a concept of area vector. Suppose you consider a very small area, ds let us say. This is area, that's all. If you draw a line perpendicular to that, such that the length of the line to some scale gives the area, then this automatically will become area vector. Because angles are always should be represented between two vectors. So area is different, area vector is different. Area vector is always normal to the area. Okay. So we have represented, now we have established area vector. Another requirement is field vector. This is magnetic field, therefore B. So in this sketch immediately you should be able to recollect same thing we did. Instead of B, we wrote E, that's all. Electric field and area vector. So angle between them automatically, let us say, is equal to what? Theta. Now what happens is, there is a magnetic field, there is an area, so naturally there must be a magnetic flux. Normally when we talk about magnetic flux, we say normal. Normal flux. Why we'll discuss that. Why you should add that word normal, that is perpendicular. Now, if you look at this field vector, magnetic field vector, even though it passes through this area, it makes an angle theta with the area vector. So, whenever there is an angle, that vector can be resolved. So, if I resolve this, so this automatically will become B cos theta and this becomes B sin theta. One component along this, one component. And if you look at this B sin theta, you will find that it passes over the area. It does not pass through the area. So this is where you have to be careful. Just because there is a magnetic field and area does not mean that the entire magnetic field is responsible for magnetic flux. You have to be very careful about that. How much part of that magnetic, total magnetic field is responsible for magnetic flux? That you have to always see. So, in this particular case, you see that there is a component B sin theta which passes over the area, whereas there is a component B cos theta which is normal to the area, perpendicular to the area, or parallel to the area vector. Now you see, this does not contribute to any flux. So even though there is a total field B, a part of the field, that is the advantage of vectors. Okay, we can actually pull out useful part of that total. Therefore, even though there is B, B sin theta does not contribute to any magnetic flux, B cos theta contributes. So it is B cos theta which is responsible for magnetic flux, therefore a small magnetic flux B phi is equal to effective field B cos theta multiplied by area. This is how we define magnetic flux. So, okay, number of field lines passing through the area, fine. That is a different definition. But like I said, we can always argue that definition because how many lines really you can count. But this way, no problem. There is a clear boundary area and there is a clear magnitude, magnetic field. Only thing that we should look for is what is the angle between the area vector and the magnetic field vector. If you look into that is enough. So that is a magnetic flux. Therefore, B phi is equal to so this represent the magnetic flux. A small magnetic flux. If you want really this one, then they write it as B A cos theta or B dot B. and A is the total area. Here I consider only a very small area, here an entire area. Okay, so that is how we define magnetic flux. Now we have to write the unit. So for just because it is dot product, by this time you must have guessed that magnetic flux is a scalar quantity. Okay, next is magnetic field, that is Tesla area meters. Therefore Tesla meter square is the magnetic flux, unit of magnetic flux, or SI unit of magnetic flux, Tesla meter square, not per. Okay, so we can define magnetic field Tesla in a different way. See, as we learn more and more things, you know, the definition also changes. Now from this you can easily see that, let us assume that the cos theta component is not there. B is equal to, okay, B is equal to phi over B. So magnetic field can also be defined as magnetic flux per unit area. Therefore magnetic flux Tesla meter square, area meter square. Therefore we know that it is Tesla. So we can define magnetic field as magnetic flux per unit area. That you should remember. Next is I am just warning you, because there is an area and because there is a magnetic field does not necessarily mean magnetic flux. This is going to be very useful in immediate future, near future. Okay, this particular information, how much of this magnetic field is linked to how much portion of the area, that is very very important. Suppose let us say there is a rectangular area frame. I keep a circular conductor and I pass current through that. We know that whenever there is a current through a conductor, a magnetic field is created. Therefore, through this circular area, there will be a magnetic field created by this current. So these magnetic field lines will emerge out. When they emerge out, they will pass through the rectangular thing. But we can easily see that even though we have this much area, let's say some L and some B, whatever it is, these magnetic field lines are passing through only this much area, equal to the area of the conductor. So your flux calculation should consider only this area, even though the other area is available. Hope you have understood. So again, don't go by this full area. It is magnetic field, area, yes, both are important, but that effective area only you should consider through which the magnetic field line passes. Therefore these areas are all empty. No magnetic field line is passing through them. Only through this area magnetic field lines are passing. So whatever is the radius of the circular conductor, convert it into area, then magnetic field, you know how to find the magnetic field into a circular one, mu naught I divided by 2R or 2A, whatever, to radius of the circular. So you can find the magnetic field, you know its own area, multiply, you will get the magnetic flux. So effective area you should always identify. One more. Suppose this frame is placed in a magnetic field. By this time you must be aware of this symbol. This only thing is, it is a magnetic field now, perpendicular and towards the pole. You are seeing the tail of that arrow. Therefore this represents a magnetic field perpendicular to the board and towards the board. Again, here also you have to consider this area only for your magnetic flux calculations. these areas we should ignore. On the other hand, if this rectangular frame is placed in a magnetic field, then you have to consider the entire area of the rectangle for your magnetic field calculation. So this is one point you please remember. Effective area is very, very important. Okay. This, throughout this chapter, that's what we are going to look for. Particularly self-induction, mutual induction, all these things we are going to study. Okay. So, introduction to this particular chapter is magnetic flux. We'll go to the next one. The topic itself. What do you mean by electromagnetic induction? So, Michael Faraday and Henry, they have done a lot of work in this. If Oersted discovered magnetic effect of electric current, Michael Faraday discovered the benefit of it. He found that it is basic, concept, physics concept, very typical physics concept. That means we observe the things, then we put a mathematical model for it. Whenever the magnetic flux linked to an area, whenever a magnetic flux linked to an area changes, there is an EMF, that is electromotive force, voltage induced in the conductor, and if a path is provided, then there is a current. Because when you have a wire in the form of a rectangle or whatever it is, it has some resistance. Definitely there will be some resistance. So voltage divided by resistance will give you what? Current. That means whenever a magnetic flux linked to an area changes with respect to time, there is an EMF induced in the coil or in that area, and hence there is a current induced. One particular case we are going to take later where EMF will be induced, but there won't be any current because it's an open circuit. It will be an open circuit. For current to flow, we require a closed circuit. But what is guaranteed is EMF is guaranteed. What is not guaranteed is current. That depends on the circuit. We are going to make use of this particular phenomenon. So whenever the magnetic flux linked with a coil changes with respect to time, then EMF is induced and hence a current is induced in the coil. This phenomenon is known as electromagnetic induction. A current is induced, induction means induced, due to what? Because of the magnetic effect. That is why the entire electricity and magnetism is now combined into electromagnetism. One complements the other. We have seen current producing a magnetic field, Oersted discovery. In this chapter, we are going to see a magnetic field producing a current. That AC, Danda, we are getting, you know, it's all because of electromagnetic induction. One is complementary to the other. We cannot really, even though they are two different things, but we have to consider as Advaita principle. We have to consider as a single one. Okay. Again, what are the conditions? Mere existence of magnetic flux is not enough. It should be changing. It should be changing. We'll discuss in detail what actually happens when magnetic flux changes. Whenever there is a change in the magnetic flux, there will be induced current. Okay. Straight away I will go for induced current. Okay. I do not tell it in two steps. Induced EMF and then induced current, except I told you, except one case where only EMF you are going to consider, that is called motional EMF. Okay. So, change in the magnetic flux is very important. Again, you have to understand this very carefully. The quantum of magnetic flux really doesn't matter. If it is constant, the magnetic flux, if it is there, and if it remains a constant, it is no use. On the other hand, you have very small magnitude of the magnetic flux, but it is changing with respect to time, then there will be induced current. So it is the change in the magnetic flux that is very, very important for current. Okay. So we talk about direction of force. First, we will finish with Faraday's laws. He says, see, very straightforward for expression it is. Flux is equal to magnetic field into area into cos of the angle between the two. Then the two means what? The magnetic field direction and area vector direction. Cos of that angle. What are the various ways in which we can change the magnetic flux? I can create a setup in such a way the magnetic field can be continuously changed. We can do that. After all, it requires a solenoid. Solenoid B is equal to, we know that mu naught n into I. N may be fixed, number of turns per unit length. Mu naught may be fixed, but I can go on varying the current. Hence, magnetic field will continuously change. I can keep the area constant. Direction also I will keep constant. There will be change in magnetic flux. That means there will be induced EMF. On the other hand, I will keep the B constant. This is what they do in hydroelectric power stations, thermal electric power stations, nuclear power stations, where a coil is mounted. Coil is mounted between two powerful magnetic poles. That is fixed. Magnetic poles are fixed. Once you fix magnetic poles, naturally magnetic field, both magnitude as well as direction, it is fixed. No change. So the only thing that you can now do is what? Change the area. So keep the magnetic field constant, change the area. Then also there will be change in the magnetic flux. Automatically there will be induced current. Or you can change both. Both magnetic field as well as area you can. They must be changing. That's, there must be a change in the magnetic field. Okay, magnetic flux. So when you differentiate, so it's a derivative, therefore d phi by dt. That is rate of change of magnetic flux. That will be induced EMF. And I put a minus sign. Next, when you learn Lenz's law, you will understand why that minus sign is. Okay. So, rate of change of magnetic flux with respect to time is equal to induced EMF. Rate of change of magnetic flux with respect to time is induced EMF. That you should know. The negative sign, it indicates a very important thing, that is next law. Okay, but we have not finished with the Faraday's laws yet. So as long as the magnetic flux is changing, the induced EMF will be there. That is Faraday's first law. The moment the flux becomes constant, and we know that derivative of a constant is equal to zero. So automatically this derivative will become what? Zero. That means induced EMF will be zero. This epsilon is a symbol for induced EMF. Later on we will write capital B. Okay. At the end of this chapter and the entire chapter. Anyway, I want to tell one more thing. This chapter is electromagnetic induction. Okay. Next chapter is AC, alternating current. But I am not going to consider that as two different chapters. Okay, they are same chapters only. Because of the volume, they have split at some point and made it to two chapters. But I am just going to continue till I finish AC. Okay. So, because same ideas, no change. Only thing is bulk, very bulky. So, this is going to be a very big chapter and it is going to take considerable time also. But very, very important chapter. Okay. Let me tell you one thing, that is, from board point of view, there will be five numericals given. You have to answer any three numericals. Five marks questions. So 15 marks are there for numericals. The speciality of that is, there are two modules, okay, blueprints, okay, two things, okay. But in both the numericals, one particular chapter that you will find common in both the modules is AC and this one, electromagnetic. So, one 5-mark question numerical is guaranteed. Remaining under, suppose they ask in electric charge and field, they won't ask any problem in potential and capacity, and vice versa. Suppose they ask a numerical in electric potential and capacitor, then there won't be any numericals in electric field and electric force and field and electric charge. Similarly, current electricity, like that. But this one guaranteed. One question definitely. Similarly, in optics also, if there is a numerical in ray optics, there will be numerical in wave optics and vice versa. In modern physics, if there is a numerical in nucleus, there won't be any numerical in atoms, etc. And that is how it is given. But the one particular chapter that you will find in both blueprint is this particular chapter. So 5 marks at the end of this chapter is guaranteed. Okay. So the negative rate of change of magnetic flux with respect to time is induced EMF. Negative rate of change of magnetic flux. So from this you can easily see that magnetic flux has to change. The moment it becomes constant, the derivative becomes zero. Therefore, there won't be any induced EMF. Again, changing means what? Changing magnetic flux means what? That is the advantage of electromagnetic induction. It really does not depend on how it changes, how the magnetic flux changes. As long as it is changing, that is enough. That means from a higher magnetic flux to lower level of magnetic flux is a change in magnetic flux. There will be induction. On the other hand, lower value to higher value. What I am trying to say is, decreasing magnetic flux or increasing magnetic flux doesn't really matter. As long as the magnetic flux is changing enough, there will be induced EMF and induced current. So it is the change that is important, not the value. And the faster, that is the second law. Automatically, the question will be, okay, how much voltage I am going to get? The benefit I am, how much voltage, high voltage or lower voltage? So that I can calculate how much current I am going to get, etc. That's an automatic next question. That is second law. The induced EMF, or the magnitude of the induced, let's not worry about direction at present, even though EMF is not a vector quantity. But next law we will talk about that. The faster rate at which the magnetic flux is changing, more fast it is changing, more voltage will be. If the magnetic flux changes very fast, that means change in the magnetic flux occurs within a very small interval of time. That is, denominator is very, very small. Even though change in the flux, d5 represents change in the flux, it may be small. But if the denominator is much smaller, then the voltage produced will be very high. On the other hand, if the magnetic flux is changing slowly, that means not fast enough. Rate d5 by dt itself is very slow. So obviously d5 by dt value will be lesser. Therefore, induced EMF also will be lesser. If the magnetic flux is not changing, there won't be any induced EMF. So, three things. Faster the magnetic flux changes, then higher will be the voltage. Please remember, don't mean, thinking elsewhere. Faster the magnetic flux changes, higher will be the voltage produced. Slower the magnetic flux is changing, lower will be the voltage produced. No change in the magnetic flux, no voltage will be produced. So, the magnitude of the voltage depends on purely how fast the magnetic flux is changing. So, as per your requirement, you have to see that the magnetic flux is changing at a certain rate. If you want very high voltage, it has to change. The magnetic flux has to change at a faster rate and so on. So, Again, I am stressing that it is the change in the magnetic flux that is very, very important, not the magnetic flux. It is the change in the magnetic flux that is responsible for electromagnetic induction. Okay. Next. Right. In which direction the current is going to flow, or in which direction the EMF is going to be produced, which direction means, again, understand it wrongly, which is going to be positive terminal, which is going to be negative terminal. It's going to act like a battery, so there must be a positive terminal and negative terminal. For this, there is one law called Lenz law, L-E-N-Z, L-E-N-Z. Lenz law. In fact, this gentleman gave the direction of the induced current. He based his discovery on the conservation of energy. That is, the direction of the induced EMF or the direction of the current will be such that to oppose the one which is causing it. So it is little difficult to understand, but once you concentrate, it is very simple. If electromagnetic induction takes place due to some action, then the direction of the induced current will produce a reaction to oppose this action. It is always against the one which causes induction. The direction of the induced EMF and current will be such that it will oppose the one which is causing it. Okay, we will take one experiment, then you will understand this. This Tesla meter square, that is phi, is written as Weber. So again, another scientist, Weber, or we can write like this, capital W, small b. This is the unit of magnetic flux. Tesla meter square is nothing but Weber. Okay. So many scientists are contributing to, new things. So you have to accommodate all those gentlemen. Okay. We have to honor them. That's why in physics you will find that many physical quantities, units are named after scientists. Okay. But again, you should never forget the fundamental units in terms of length, mass, time, and of course electric current is a fundamental unit. You should never forget them. Even though the units are in what scientist's name, you have to take care. So Weber is one such thing. There are three experiments we can discuss. Okay, we can do that today. One is called magnet coil experiment. Another is circuit coil experiment. Another is coil experiment. Okay. Not many things are given in the textbook. I'll therefore quickly go through all these things. Suppose you consider a coil and is connected to what is known as, that is another new thing that you are going to learn, zero-centered galvanometer. It is called zero-centered galvanometer. Normally, any measuring instrument, when you go through that, when you observe that, they will have zero at one end, then scales will be there, graduations will be there, and the maximum value will be on the rightmost side. That is normal practice. Whether it is ammeter or voltmeter, whatever it is, zero to gradually increasing at the maximum. Here, the zero will be at the center. Zero will be at the center. Indicator. Then, one left side and another. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, like minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. So, So normally you won't come across such instruments, because when measuring we will never bother about the direction. Okay, just want to know value. When you connect an ammeter in a circuit, you just want to know how much current is flowing. Similarly, voltmeter, what's the potential difference across the resistor. But some experiments, because you have to prove certain things, require a device which will show reversal of direction. One such instrument is zero-centered galvanometer. Okay, so that is fixed here. Why galvanometer, why not ammeter? That means galvanometer being a very sensitive instrument, even a small current produced, it will register. Okay, suppose it is normally it is called as milliammeter. Milliammeter means what? It can measure up to 1 milli of an ampere. Similarly, microammeter, it can measure up to 1 microampere current. So like that, they are all very sensitive galvanometer. Suppose you consider a magnetic dipole, simply a bar magnet, then you keep it like this, keep it this in position, we'll start the experiment. If I start moving this bar magnet towards a coil, see, now what happens is, when you keep a bar magnet like this, okay, from north pole to south pole, plenty of magnetic field lines will be there. So, it all around this there will be magnetic field lines, and some of these magnetic field lines will be linked to the coil. That means a magnetic flux is there. Finish. That is the first requirement. But the magnetic flux will remain constant as long as this is also stationary, this is also stationary. Now what is done is, move the bar magnet. Let us say, with north pole moving towards the coil. As the bar magnet comes nearer and nearer, to the coil, more and more magnetic field lines will pass through the area. And this is where the first definition of magnetic flux will help you. What's the first definition? Number of magnetic field lines passing through an area. That is the magnetic flux. So as the bar magnet moves towards the coil, what happens is more and more magnetic field lines are going to be linked to the coil. That is enough. That is a change in the magnetic flux. You know, immediately this will register a deflection, indicating that a current is flowing. Mind you, there is no connection between these two, and this is not connected to any source of EMF. Okay, simply a coil connected to an instrument, that's a measuring instrument. But magic, you see, as you move this bar magnet towards a coil, yeah, current is produced. Okay. Similarly, now let's say when it was moving like this, it produced a deflection, let us say, towards right. Now, keeping the polarity of the magnet as it is, you move it away from the coil. Move the bar magnet away from the coil. Now what will happen? When the bar magnet was very closer to the coil, there were maximum number of magnetic field lines were linked to the coil. So as the bar magnet moves away from the coil, slowly one by one, some of the magnetic field lines will leave the coil, So naturally what happens, that also will be what? Change in flux. That is enough. Change in flux means there will be electric current. Only thing is, in order to indicate that the direction has reversed, this zero center galvanometer now will produce a deflection on the other side, indicating that the direction of the current in these two cases are quite opposite. That is what happens in electromagnetic induction. Periodically, the direction of the current will be changing. That AC that you are getting here, alternating current, okay, it is 50 cycles per second, 50 cycles per second, okay, 50. Just imagine, it is changing direction. That's why we don't perceive that change, because it is happening so fast. We don't say, so this light actually, it is zero, maximum, back to zero, maximum the opposite direction, zero, maximum, like that. But we don't see that. We see that light continuously, it is glowing, but change is taking place. But it is very fast. Therefore, our eye is not able to perceive that. But that is, whenever the direction changes, the direction of the current also changes. So, this is what is known as bar magnet coil experiment. Importantly, particularly in this, because there is one thing that is moving. So, whenever there is movement, another important point that you should always remember is there must be a relative motion between the two things. For example, this is the coil and this is the bar magnet. And I move the bar magnet towards the coil, yes, there will be induction. I move the bar magnet away from the coil, yes, there will be induction. Suppose I hold the bar magnet, keep the coil moving towards the bar magnet, there will be induction. Move it away, again there will be induction. Because in all the four cases I told you just now, there is change of magnetic flux. Now we'll go to the next case. You fix the bar magnet, you fix the coil, move them together. Very similar to Doppler's effect. Very similar to Doppler's effect. In Doppler's effect also, there must be a relative motion between the listener and the source. Similarly, here also, there must be a relative motion. Here what happens is, when you keep the bar magnet fixed and the coil fixed and move them in the same direction, at the same speed, the distance between them is not changing. When the distance between them is not changing, the magnetic field lines through the coil is not going to change. Therefore, magnetic flux is not going to change. Therefore, there won't be any induction. So, just because there is a magnetic field, now I am adding a third element to this. Just because there is a magnetic field, and just because there is a area, and just because there is a motion, again, does not guarantee induction. Okay? Motion must be relative. That means the distance between the two things must be changing with respect to time. So, this is what is known as coil magnet experiment. Now, we will apply Lenz's law. What I am going to do is, I am going to draw this coil from this side. That is, I am as if I am facing like this. This is the first turn of the coil you are facing. It is perpendicular to the board. Okay, that means coil is going like this, like keeping a tube. Okay, like this. Now, this is a bar magnet. This is the bar magnet. Let us say this black end is the north pole. Okay, I am going to keep like this. Okay, now I will move this towards the coil. It will produce current in the circular coil. It will produce a current in the circular coil in such a way, as per Lenz's law, it has to oppose this. What is oppose what? Oppose any action which is causing induction. What is causing induction here? Movement of the bar magnet with the north pole towards the coil is causing the electromagnetic induction. Two things you should remember. One is movement of the bar magnet, and with what polarity, that is also important. With the north pole and moving towards the coil, all these things you should consider. So it has to oppose it. That means what? This should induce a current in such a way, its phase should become a north pole. Its phase should become what? North pole. So that this north pole and this north pole will be what? Creating a repulsive force, so that this bar magnet is pushed back. Because moving it towards the coil is the one which is causing what? Induction. Therefore, the induced current will be in such a direction, it has to oppose that. Therefore, you know, where long back I told you, you draw one N here. That means current will be in an anti-clockwise sense. Immediately, a current will be induced in the coil in an anti-clockwise sense. If the bar magnet with its north pole is moved towards the coil. Next, on the other hand, suppose I move it away, but I am not changing the configuration. Say a north pole is facing the coil, only thing is the bar magnet is moved away from the coil. So, movement of the bar magnet with north pole facing the coil away from the coil is causing induction now. Induction will be there because magnetic flux will change. Again, it has to oppose that. It has to oppose that. That means it should not allow the bar magnet to move away. It has to attract it. So, naturally, this is north pole facing the coil. Naturally, if it has to attract, naturally this face of the coil has to behave like a south pole. In that case, the current will be in the clockwise axis. That's why in this galvanometer, okay, zero center galvanometer, when the bar magnet was moving towards the coil, the direction of the current was in one particular way, and when the same bar magnet is moved away from the coil, if the direction quite reverses, because Lenz's law is that the induced current should always oppose the one which causes it. The direction of the induced current should always oppose the one which causes it. So that is Lenz's law. So this is what is known as magnet coil experiment. Next is, instead of a magnet, we will have a magnetic effect. We will have a magnetic effect. For example, I can say a solenoid, okay, connected to a source. Okay. A solenoid. The moment that source is there, current will be flowing to that. So, you not have any steady current will flow. So, there will be magnetic effect. That means the solenoid is going to behave like a bar magnet. That's all. So I don't want to explain too much on this. Okay. Moving the solenoid towards a coil. In the two experiments I have described, one of them is moving. So moving the coil towards the solenoid, moving towards this coil, naturally this is a magnet. It is behaving like a magnet. Magnetic flux, change in the magnetic flux, then we induce current. And again, moving away will give you again current. The next one is no movement, totally no movement. That is coil experiment. That means you keep one coil zero center. This is another coil. This diagram, putting this symbol, you will come across. It indicates varying current. That's all. It indicates varying current. So when the current through the solenoid is increasing or decreasing or changing, naturally the magnetic field produced by the coil also will change. Therefore, the magnetic field lines linked with this coil also will change. Immediately it will show you difference. That means there is no connection between these two coils, but still by changing the current in one coil, we can induce current in the other coil. This is what is known as coil experiment. Okay. Coil experiment. By changing means what? I can increase the current, then there will be one current in one particular direction. I can decrease the current, again there will be current in the other coil, but in the opposite direction. So these are the various ways in which we can produce electromagnetic induction or current. I want you to send your answer. One question, I will stop here, of course. There is a coil. Your battery, okay, this is a battery, steady source of EMF. Current is flowing through this coil. Will there be induction? Okay. You have got area, you have got magnetic field, you have got the directions also. Okay, I want you to tell me by sending your answer, will there be electromagnetic induction in the coil? Okay, this is a battery, okay, that you remember. So just see what you have done today is, we talked about magnetic flux, change in the magnetic flux, which causes current, induced current, and of course the direction of current. And in order to demonstrate that, we did all these things. Okay, tomorrow we will continue this. Okay. And before I leave, all the best with your results. Okay, God bless you. Okay, hope everyone have done very well. Best of luck. Okay, thank you.